We'll start with the next part of the mathematical modeling topic. So let's see how I get this thing right. What we are going to look at is now if the motor is added with the load. So far we have seen the modeling of motor and friction. So different models of friction we have seen. Although those models were defined for a block on a flat surface, those models can be easily seen to be translated into a rotary kind of a joint. Friction at the rotary joint, as in the bearing case in the motor. Okay, so that part is this friction here. And now what we are going to do is typically motors are not alone. They'll have some load or some application to be driven. And when that application is getting driven by the motor, this torque corresponding to that on the motor side will come. Okay, so this is like a load torque, but which is seen on the motor side. Okay, so that's why this torque tau ml. Okay, this m stands for the torque on the motor side, and l is it's actually because of the load. So now say we have this load, as we have seen in the CD-ROM drive, some kind of a bell drive operated here. So there is further that bell drive is driving gear, and that gear is driving some kind of a tray, but we are not kind of considering that for now. Okay, we are just considering simple load here. Okay, simple gear kind of a or the bell driven rotary disc here. For such a case, how do you think about now getting the getting this belt connection modeled? Okay, if you plug in your kinematics and dynamics of machines fundamentals, this is pretty straightforward. Remember, this is like a rigid joint, a rigid body motion, but this is rotary motion for the rigid body. This is one rigid body and this is another rigid body, and there is a coupling of belt in between. Now this belt is considered to be some kind of a rigid coupling, and it also has is a massless kind of a coupling. Okay, normally belts, if you see, they are stretchable. Okay, one can stretch it and they will have some kind of a flexibility. We are not modeling that flexibility here. Okay, so it depends upon how deep you want to get into the modeling. Okay, depending upon what is your interest. Say if you are interested in very accurately driving this output load, okay, and the belt is very very flexible, that okay, it can get stretched when it is getting driven. The stretch is quite a bit, then you may need to consider flexibility in the belt, some kind of a spring here. But when it is now, let's consider to begin with a simple case where this is just driven in some kind of a rigid connection of the belt, and belt is massless. Okay, so belt mass and belt inertia we are ignoring, because it will be much lesser as compared to the motor and load inertias. Okay, so now with this, you can see that we need to draw a free body diagram to get these two rigid bodies considered. Okay, how will you draw this free body diagram? Just pause here for a while and then draw it yourself, and then we'll see further. So we have to draw the free body diagram and then see the concept of equivalent inertia. Okay, we'll see this, what is this concept. But you draw the free body diagram here and then we can see in the next slide. Okay, so you can see your free body diagram is up here. So you have these tensions in the belt which are differential. okay. So if this is a motor which is getting driven on this in this direction, motor which is driving the belt in this direction, so the motor is rotating in this direction, the tension in this side is going to be higher than tension in the other side. Okay, so this T1 is more than T2. Can you see that why? Okay, pretty straightforward to kind of see that, okay, T1 will be higher than T2. So we are assuming that, you know, here the belt is not slipping. So this difference in the tensions is going to produce some kind of a torque here. So you remember these are our, like, you know, motor equations on motor side, mechanical equations, and in that we have this this load which is we are considering right now, load torque. So this load torque now can be written. So you can you write these equations? How do you write this equation for tau ml here? So in terms of T1 and T2, one can see that these equations are going to be like this. Okay, so T1 minus T2 times our radius, like the radius of the motor shaft, will get you this tau ml. Okay, now if we see this expression, this expression will be on the motor side. Okay, what is the connection to the load side? Same tensions on the load side will be existing, T1 and T2 in the belt. Okay, belt is continuous, and like, you know, here this action and reaction forces will exist up there. Now one can write this tau ml is equal to tau m, like tau on the load side is equal to, in terms of this these two tensions on the load side. Okay, so let us call that torque as tau l. Okay, so tau l is a torque which will be applied by the motor to the load. Okay, so it's like a driven, like, you know, driving torque to the load. So load is getting driven by this torque tau l. And when load is driven by the torque tau l, on the motor side we see the torque ml as a load torque, tau ml. So that is how, like, we can consider this. So you, if you feel this is little, I mean, you can see the same thing without even considering this, like, you know, this tau ml or tau l as a separate kind of a quantities. Okay, these are just variables to kind of physically understand stuff more nicely, actually. So if you see that tau l will be T1 minus T2 into RL. Okay, RL is a radius of this load disc, and RM was a radius on the motor disc here. Okay, so this ratio between the two will be n. Okay, so when one can see that this tau l is equal to n times tau ml. So see, since the load side gear is bigger in size, the torque that is applied by the motor, okay, if it is on the motor side is tau ml, then on the load side it gets like larger. Okay, this n is a ratio of radius RL divided by RM. Okay, so RL is larger here and RM is lesser here, so this is like a number which is greater than 1. So your torque enhancement happens when you have a bigger size disc, which you all very well know. The same thing will happen with the gears also, same way. Okay, so you also can see that, you know, theta L will be equal to theta M upon N. Okay, so the gear or this belt arrangement enhances the torque but reduces the theta value or the displacement value. Okay, the displacement value of theta L will get reduced by factor of N. Okay, which is straightforward to see. I don't see this. This is just a simple kind of a kinematics of this belt drive. Okay, now what are these complete equations yet? Yes, okay, these are not complete equations yet. Okay, we need to further develop equations of motion based on the motion of this side. So we have written the equation for motion on this side. We have developed some kinematic relationships between these two sides in terms of, like, you know, both the torque and the theta. Okay, but still we don't have the equation of motion coming up on the load side. Okay, so how do we do that? Again, we go back to our kinematics and dynamics of machines fundamentals, and we can see here that in the summation of moments is equal to J times alpha will give you equation of motion on the load side. So apply this and like, you know, see what all equations you can get and simplify them and see. Okay, so you pause here for a while and then do this, and then we'll further see. Okay, if your equations are done, now we can see here. Look, you have JL theta L double dot plus BL theta L dot. Now this BL theta L dot, as we had on the motor side, you have some kind of a bearing friction coming up on the load side also. Okay, that is what we have written here, and that is equal to the torque which is driving the load, tau L. Okay, now we know this tau L is nothing but N times tau ML, and then now one can get right equation expression for tau ML in terms of these quantities here. So we can substitute that in our original equation. Okay, so this we substitute in our motor side equation, and we get now, so here we are considering still friction torque here. But we are not kind of really considering a model for friction yet. One can assume this to be zero also to simplify the analysis and see stuff without friction, what is that we can see. Okay, so now one can see that, okay, this is load theta double dot and theta L dot. Now they can be transformed into the same quantity theta M here. Okay, how do you transform that? Theta L, you know, is equal to theta M upon N. Okay, so when you use that, you get this equation. So you get this N square term here, and now you collect the like terms which are multiplying theta M double dot and theta M dot, and then you can see your equation gets to this form. This is very interesting, you can see now. Okay, so we get something like a equivalent inertia up here. Okay, so this reads like, you know, JM plus JL upon N square. So like, you know, see if N is really really very large, okay, so say N is 3 for example, okay, then your inertia L, JL, is reduced when it is seen by the motor by 9, factor of 9. Okay, so if the gear reduction is really really high, then as compared to the motor side, like, you know, the load inertia value will be very very, as compared to the motor inertia JM, the load inertia seen on the motor side, okay, this term is going to have a insignificant kind of value. Can you see that? So this, for this value to be very significant, you need to have a load inertia much much larger than motor inertia. Okay, so this is very very interesting, you know, physical understanding up here. So one can kind of say, okay, oh look, I'll just kind of account for my load side inertia by collecting, like, you know, by saying, okay, it may be like, you know, at most 4.2 or 0.35 times motor inertia, and I can kind of like directly say this JM equivalent is equal to some factor into JM. That can be one simplification one can do. Depends upon, like, you know, how do you have the inertias on the load side and how much is the gear reduction. So you can work out some numbers for some specific cases, and you'll find that, okay, oh look, this values of load inertia, although, like, you know, it looks very big that, okay, this motor is driving big inertia, when it is transformed on the motor side, it has not much of a you know, value there. Okay, so this is a very important understanding here. Now we can reach the same understanding by energy way also. Okay, how can you think about that? So instead of, like, you know, writing all these you know, free body diagrams, say if, especially if there are multiple connections, so far we have considered only one belt connection, then there are gears, then there are some rack and pinion, or some kind of a, like, you know, gearing system is there. whole of that gearing system would have a degree of freedom still 1. Okay, so motor position, if it is specified, all the positions in the system get specified. Okay, that's what happens in this case also, right? You see that, you know, when the motor position is specified, like, you know, load position is specified at time upon L. So that kinematics is very simple for such a cases here. So in that case, like, we can do, like, you know, some energy analysis, like, you know, a little bit of energy analysis, and reach the same conclusion. How we can do that, we can see it here. Okay, so total kinetic energy, if I want to write here, one can say that, see, from the motor side, the kinetic energy is Jm theta m dot square half, and load side it is Jl theta l dot square. Okay, there is no translational kinetic energy, and there is no nothing translating here, so we are again ignoring the belt effects. Okay, so belt inertia is ignored here. Okay, so this kinetic energy, again one can see this transformation of load side theta position versus motor side position, and after that transformation is applied, you can get the same kind of a equivalent inertia term here. Okay, so this is like equivalent motor, equivalent inertia as seen on the motor side. Okay, so by using the same kind of a principle for damping energy, okay, which is half times damping factor times theta m dot square, okay, or theta dot square in general, then one can write, like, you know, the damping also in a similar way, and you get equivalent damping, and then one can see that this whole thing translate into the same kind of a governing equation as we had seen for the case before, okay, by using a Newton's analysis, by drawing people diagrams. Okay, so this is a very important kind of consideration, that, okay, one can directly use total kinetic energy and get to the same point, okay, kinetic energy and of course the damping energy and things like that. Okay, so you can reach this equation by using the energy way, much in the simpler form, without drawing the feedback diagram. So this T1, T2 doesn't come into picture when we write this kinetic energy. Okay, so now this can be applied to a little bit more kind of a complicated cases also. So you have now here, like, you know, one gear driving the other gear, then other gear driving the third gear, then they are driving the rack and pinion, and some kind of a mass is attached to the rack and pinion, which is our CD-ROM head mass. So this is a kind of a system where we can apply this now, and you know, one can see some kind of a simplified form of expressions coming up there. Okay, so you may draw some schematic and try this out yourself if you want to. I'm just kind of giving you some kind of a, you know, small schematic here to just prompt how things will happen. Okay, but really you need to draw your own kind of a expressions. Okay, you derive your own expressions, and then, like, you know, come to this stage and, like, you know, see if they are matching and things like that. So you can see here, there are this is a motor inertia Jm here. Load inertia, I am considering only one kind of a gear instead of two gears, two reductions here. And then you have the rack and pinion, which is driving this mass. This is the mass of the CD-ROM head. Now, if you see the kinetic energy, again, you can write the same kinetic energy for Jm and Jl, but the kinetic energy for the mass will be now half m x dot square. Okay, now we need to know the kinetic relationship, kinematic relationship between the x and theta. Okay, so theta l, for example, is theta m upon n, and once you know the theta l, then you know this gear radius, say rl2, then rl2 times theta l will be x. Okay, so r theta is equal to x, that kind of a relationship we can use. So this is rl2 is like a pitch radius of a pinion which is attached to the load side and driving the rack. So this is how one can get this kinematic relationship. Once the kinematic and the relationship is known, one can substitute that, like, you know, in the energy expression, x dot will be equal to now RL2 times now theta L. I can substitute here theta m dot upon n. Okay. And once you use that into writing the total expression of kinetic energy, you are going to get this equivalent inertia on the motor side. So this, now the mass inertia here gets transformed to the motor side, okay, in proper dimensional form, which is required at the motor side, is m times r l2 square. Okay, so this is like a inertia term. This is having same kind of a dimensional quantity as jl or jm, and divided by n square still comes here. Okay, so this is very interesting way one can get to the simple systems very easily to resolve, like, you know, how many different kind of moving elements are there in the rigid system kinematically. Many of mechatronic systems would fall in this kind of a category, and one can write nicely this form of equations. One can extend these to the screwdriver also, and, you know, things like that. So you can see now that. Now another important part is, like, you know, friction in this case. So friction, as you see, you can see here, exists at these points. You remember now, right? Like, we had these two points B and C underneath, okay, where the contact happens with the rod on this side, and there is some kind of a contact happening on the other side as well. Okay, so friction would exist mainly at these points. Now if this mass is moving here, and mass is having, say, inertial force, you know, x double dot times m in this direction at passing through the cg of this mass, this force is going to have some kind of a torque. As we see that if we start doing this free body diagram for the case of this rack and mass system, okay, rack is connected here, and then we assume that, okay, these B and C points are somewhere here and here. So can you see now how the friction will come up? Okay. So especially, like, you know, is there any connection between friction and the inertia is what we want to see here. So for that, you really need to draw the free body diagram. I'll just kind of, like, you know, give you some small insight into how do you proceed, and then, like, you know, maybe you can proceed from there. Okay, so let's do that. Okay, so if you see here, I'll draw this rack. Okay, so I'll just draw some schematic for the rack. Okay, and you have this here, and then you have this big mass coming up here. Okay, now this mass, at this cg of mass, you have some x double dot, okay, or this mass here, and this is x here. Now these are the points where, like, you know, some kind of a contact is happening with the rod, so there is a reaction that is going to get developed at these points. Okay, so some reaction will be there. At we call these points as B and C. And there is this reaction here, and there is this reaction here. Now, let's assume this reaction to be, say, in this direction, and this reaction is in this direction. Okay. So if I want to write the equations of motion, how will I write here? Is what you need to think. Okay. So summation of forces in x direction is equal to mass into x double dot. Okay, is what I would write. Now at these points where these normal reactions are produced, there will be some friction that will be produced. okay, which is in the opposite direction, the motion, okay. So there is some kind of friction which is in the opposite direction with the motion. That's going to happen there. Okay, then summation of forces, say y direction, the perpendicular direction, okay, are going to be zero. Okay, because there is no motion in y direction. Okay, so let's say this is y direction here. Okay, I just put this because like no right hand thumb like there is a y direction that you get. Okay, so can you see now what is happening? And I'll also have equation for the moment, right? So this is one rigid body on which some forces are getting applied, and for that the summation of moment also is equal to zero because there is no alpha, there is no rotation of this body happening here. This body is getting only translation in the x direction. Okay, so we use these equations of motion and one can see that these reaction forces, say whatever this, let's say call this as NB here, and this is say NC here. Okay, so you'll get from this equation, you'll get NB is equal to NC. Okay, and then from this equation, one can write, so your friction force here, say this is FB or FFB. And at this point we have say force FFC. Okay, let's say capital F. Okay, so this friction is always opposing this direction of motion. So and of course you have this driving force coming from the rack somewhere. Okay, so let's say driving force point we can assume somewhere here. Okay. So this is a driving force which is coming from the pinion, the rack. Okay, so this is F, let's say call this as F pinion. Okay, so FP is your driving force which is driving the mass in the same direction as X here. And so you say that if you sum the forces up in the direction of FP, okay, FP, minus like you know, your F at P minus this FFC is equal to your mass into X double dot. Can you see that? Now FFB and FFC are our friction forces. So FFB is equal to mu times NB. And FFC is equal to mu times NC. But we don't know what is NB and NC yet. Okay. But we just know that okay, they are both equal. So we need to plug in this moment equation here. Okay. So now summation of moments, you take about what point? Say if you take the summation of moments about the center of mass, okay. So if you take about center of mass, then you get the equation. So mcg here. Okay. So then so the moment created by NB is in this clockwise direction. So you have say some distance between NB and NC. So let's first name the distances here. So you say this is X1 or XB and XC. So XB is a distance up to the point B from the center of mass. Okay, and likewise you'll have XC distance coming up here. So you'll need to kind of consider NB times XB, okay, in the clockwise direction plus n c times x c, again clockwise direction, will be opposed. Okay, you'll have this friction moment up here also, so that is in anti-clockwise direction. So minus, now your FB plus FFC. Okay, now I can consider this FP also acting as a similar kind of a point. So minus FP, okay, FP is in opposite direction, times say Y, some distance Y P, let's say. Okay, so this moment is equal to 0. Okay, this is what I'll get from here. Okay, now one can see that this FB plus FFC minus FP, okay, is minus MX double dot. Okay, like that you can substitute that, and then, like, you know, you get this NB and NC are equal. So this will happen as NB times say XB plus XC, okay, which is this total distance between these points B and C. So this distance BC will be XB plus XC, and then one can write directly, like, NB times this distance BC here, okay, and this is going to get, so you have this y distance, yp is still there, and then, like, this is equal to minus x double dot, okay, as fp plus fc minus fp is equal to minus mx double dot, this is minus, this plus, and times yp. Okay, so this is the kind of a relationship you'll get for NB, and you substitute that NB up here. Okay, we'll substitute NB here or here, whatever, and you get this in this equation. Okay, and you get some simplification then. So you'll find here now, like, this friction forces are dependent upon this mu and N value. And this N value is itself is dependent upon the X double dot term. Okay, so this, since the reactions are dependent upon X double dot inertia here, so you can see in this on this block here, see this, if this distance B and C, distance between B and C is very, very small, okay, then this NB and NC are going to be very large. See this BC value, if it is very small, okay, this value is smaller, then for the same MX double dot here, okay, MX double dot here, your NB value is going to be very, very large. Okay, see, if NB is higher, these reaction forces are higher, then that's not a very good situation, because correspondingly your friction forces are going to be higher. Okay, so friction forces are dependent upon these reaction values. Okay, so that's why we want to kind of keep this distance BC larger, so as to reduce the friction force in the system. You see that at some point, you may get into a situation that these reactions are so high that you'll have very large difficulty in moving the block. So this is how one can see the friction coming up in the system, and the need for these points B and C to be far away from each other, then your friction forces are going to be lower. So if you think that, okay, you will support only at one point, okay, so say you have you have this mass and it is guided only at one point on this side here, okay, guided only one point, single point here, then only whatever distance over which it is getting guided, the ends of those will get, will be points B and C, okay, and since they are so close together, you may feel that, you know, there is a situation of jamming coming up there. Okay, so this is how one can think and, like, you know, analyze the friction for such a case. Okay, so clear this part. So these are the ways to think about and, like, you know, generate the equations of motion that you want to use for your system, and further use them in the control development later, or in the synthesis of a system. Say in this particular case, we want to push these B and C points far away from each other to reduce the friction that is happening in the system, and then you get this equation of motion here. Now from here, it is not very direct connection as in the energy based connection to the motor side, how the friction happens to the motor side. That's not very apparent here. You need to write this equation down, and then one can kind of transform that to the motor side. Okay, so when you have friction forces to be accounted for, energies may not help you really well. But you can still see that, okay, the forces are getting still translated in terms of some kind of a gear ratio. Okay, gear ratio and, you know, rack and pinion kind of a drive kinematics. Okay, so those kind of parameters may scale your friction forces in some way. Okay, so I will leave it to you to explore that further and, you know, develop complete model for such a system and see, okay, what are the equivalent forces coming, or how the friction is coming to the motor side, this friction what we are talking about here. So that you can derive yourself and look at that in more detail later. Okay, so let's come back to our slides. So now this friction force, whatever you are considering in here, can be now considered as one of the models, that four models that we have developed for the friction, and then, like, you know, your equations will be fully ready for either simulation and analysis purpose or for control development purpose. Okay, now let's see little more complicated cases. So when you have a slider crank or, like, you know, some kind of a mechanism that is driven by your motor, then you need to see, okay, think about, say, this question, okay, what is the dynamics for such a case? In terms of this question, one can see that for a constant torque, what would be time evolution of the position? So one of the quiz problems that we had, okay, where, like, you know, you are given a simple link attached to the motor and it is driven, and what is the time evolution of the position of the motor? Of that kind of a system. Okay, so if you have a slider, so this was a simple single link. Now if you have a slider crank kind of a mechanism, then, like, you know, there will be a little more complications. Although again, those systems have single degree of freedom. Okay, slider crank mechanism or four bar kind of a system, no, those are again simple systems in terms of degrees of freedom, like only 1 degree of freedom, but there are complications in terms of nonlinear terms that are coming. And one can get to the energy methods then to handle such things. Okay, so we'll then, like, the next topic that we'll see is the Lagrangian formulation, which is completely energy based. There we don't need to consider the free body diagrams. Okay, that's a plus point for Lagrangian formulation. So that's what is the next topic that we will start with. Okay. Alright, so we'll stop here for now.